Welcome, friends. I'm Dr. Raj Srinambudripad, and today we're going to talk all about the ketogenic diet, also known as the keto diet. So the keto diet has been super popular lately. Everywhere you go, people are talking about it. It's all over YouTube and it's all over social media. So is the keto diet a fad, or does the science actually prove that it's effective? Well, as a practicing physician, board certified in internal medicine, today I'm so excited to talk in great detail all about the ketogenic diet. As always, we're going to delve into the exciting science of how it works. I'm going to distinguish dirty keto from clean keto. I'm going to go over what are the benefits and what are the challenges. So let's get started. So what is the keto diet? So the keto diet is a high fat, very low carb diet where your body burns fat into ketones. So let me give you a little bit of history. So the keto diet actually was first discovered in the early 1920s at Johns Hopkins and the Mayo Clinic. So the doctors there, they observed that children who suffered from epilepsy, which is a seizure disorder, they actually would have less seizures when they were fasting. And as you know, fasting's been around since 2000 BC. Then they figured out that if these children followed the keto diet, which was a very low carb diet, it kind of mimicked fasting and they would have less seizures. So that's how the ketogenic diet was born. So let's compare the keto diet to the standard American diet. So the standard American diet is actually really high in carbs. It's 50% carbs, 35% fat, and 15% protein. And let's face it, a lot of Americans suffer from an addiction to carbohydrates. So at this time, 75% of the US population is overweight, and 50% of those people have obesity. And half the US population has something called insulin resistance, which is the root cause of diabetes. So this obesity epidemic is really concerning, and it puts people at higher risk of heart disease, stroke, diabetes, and colon cancer. So in comparison, the ketogenic diet has very different ratios of macronutrients. So 70% of the calories come from fat. So it's a very high fat diet. And then 25% is from protein, and only 5% is from carbs. So it's a very low carb diet. So to put this in perspective, a single banana would exceed your carb quota for the day. So the idea of eating more fat to lose weight may sound counterintuitive. And for many of us, it's scary and illogical to be eating so much fat. But by eating more fat, you're gonna actually burn fat. So how is that even possible? Well, first of all, I want to make it clear that not all fats are created equal. A lot of people do what I consider a dirty keto diet. So they're eating lots of red meat and bacon and butter and cheese. And this type of diet is really high in saturated fats. So that's completely different from the clean keto diet, which I'm going to talk about today. So the clean keto diet is high in monounsaturated fats. So it's good fats from avocados, olive oil, nuts, seeds, and wild fish. So I'm going to get into the details of the clean keto diet more later in this video. But first, let's talk about what makes the keto diet different from other diets. So with most diets, when you give your body less fuel, your hunger hormone, which is called ghrelin, it cranks way up. This increases your desire to eat and triggers those cravings for carbs. And your satiety hormone, which is known as leptin, it doesn't work as well. So the keto diet is very different because it breaks you free of this carb cycle by shutting down one of your main metabolic hormones, known as insulin. So one of the biggest problems of this country is insulin resistance. So insulin is the hormone that tells your body's cells to take up blood sugar, and insulin's made by your pancreas. But the problem is if your cells start ignoring insulin, then your pancreas responds by increasing the production of insulin. So we call this insulin resistance. And it's a big problem because insulin makes you hungry and it tells your cells to store fat. A lot of people don't even know that they have insulin resistance because most doctors only check the fasting glucose and the hemoglobin A1C, which is the marker of the blood sugars for a 3-month period. And you can actually have a normal fasting glucose and hemoglobin A1C, but still have this big underlying problem of high insulin. So I like to think of it as this big underlying iceberg. The insulin is what's driving the inflammation and the weight gain and the hunger. And it can be the root cause of type 2 diabetes. So I have a whole video dedicated to insulin resistance. And if you'd like to learn more about it, I'm going to link that below. The other great thing about the keto diet is that fats make you feel full. They increase your satiety. So you don't even have to worry about counting calories. So it can be a really great diet for a lot of people. To put things in perspective, if you want an out-of-control ravenous appetite, go ahead and eat lots of carbs and starches, because that's going to crank your insulin and your ghrelin way up, putting you on a roller coaster of hunger and cravings that never stop. So how does the keto diet work? Well, let's get into it. So the keto diet is shifting the way your body burns fuel. So a lot of people want to burn fat, but they just don't know how to get their body to burn fat. So ketosis is the ultimate way to shift your body into burning fat as fuel. So first we have to understand how our body stores fuel. So carbohydrates are an immediate fuel. So carbohydrates turn into glucose, which your body can use immediately for energy, or you can store it as glycogen, which is an intermediate fuel, or fat, which is a long-term fuel. So glycogen is basically a lot of glucose molecules linked together, and you store it in your liver and in your muscles, and that can be broken down anytime back into glucose. So fat is a long-term fuel, and we have two different types of fat. We have visceral fat, which is the fat surrounding our internal organs, and then we have subcutaneous fat, which is the fat under our skin that we can actually pinch on our body. So of these, the visceral fat is actually the more dangerous fat because it's the one that can cause insulin resistance. When we break down fats, we generate ketones, and that's what we want in the keto diet. So now I want to introduce you to two opposing metabolic hormones that we have in our body. So I already talked about insulin. Insulin's made by the beta cells in the pancreas, and it tells your body to store glucose and store fat. The opposing hormone is called glucagon. So glucagon is actually made by the alpha cells of the pancreas, and it tells your body to break down glycogen and break down fat. So insulin and glucagon, they are counterbalancing and opposite hormones in our body. So when you eat a lot of carbs and sugars, your insulin goes up. The opposite is true for glucagon. When there's minimal food coming in, then glucagon goes up and it tells your body to break down glycogen and then fat. So the keto diet kind of tricks your body. Because there's minimal carbs and sugars coming in, insulin gets shut down and glucagon gets turned on. Now that we've established all of this, let me walk you through all the steps that happen leading up to ketosis. So I'm going to break it down into stages. And this was actually first described by Dr. George Cahill, who was a professor at Harvard Medical School. So let's say you eat a regular meal for dinner, which consists of salmon, some white rice, and some vegetables. So stage one is the first 4 hours after eating the meal. So your blood glucose is going to go up because of the carbohydrates in this meal, which was the rice. And that's going to trigger your insulin to go up and also something called mTOR. And insulin and mTOR tell your body to store the glucose as glycogen, which is that intermediate fuel, and fat, which is that long-term fuel. Stage two is the post-absorptive stage. So this happens anywhere from 4 to 16 hours after the meal. So let's say you wake up the next morning and you decide to go for a run before even eating breakfast. So on the run, your body is actually going to break down glycogen, that intermediate fuel, back into glucose to give you energy for that run. This is also why a lot of my diabetic patients, they notice that their fasting blood glucose is high in the morning. And they're confused by this because they haven't even eaten anything. Well, that's because your body is releasing glucose from your glycogen stores, which is that intermediate fuel. Stage three is gluconeogenesis. And this happens anywhere from 16 to 30 hours after the last meal. So gluconeogenesis literally means the creation of glucose, and usually it's from proteins. Now I know this sounds bad. I mean, using your proteins to make glucose? Nobody wants to break down their muscle. But actually this is a good thing, because this is when you activate something called autophagy. So autophagy means self-eating, and this is when you're actually cleaning up all your cellular garbage, a lot of which is proteins. So autophagy is a great way to lower inflammation in your body. And I have a whole video dedicated to autophagy. If you'd like to learn more, I'm going to link that below. Stage four is finally ketosis. And this can happen anywhere from 2 days to 1 week after your last meal. So in ketosis, you're finally mobilizing your fat stores into ketones. And this process happens in the liver. And this is important because your whole body can use free fatty acids as a fuel source, except for one very important organ, your brain. your brain can only use glucose or ketones. So what happens is the free fatty acids get released from your fat and it comes to your liver, and your liver turns it into ketones. And there's three major types of ketones. There's acetone, acetoacetate, and beta-hydroxybutyrate. And what's fascinating is research shows that beta-hydroxybutyrate actually acts as a signal molecule to suppress your appetite. So no wonder people feel great and they're not hungry on a keto diet. The other great thing is beta-hydroxybutyrate inhibits something called NF-kappa beta, but basically what it means is it reduces inflammation in your brain cells and neurons, so it can be neuroprotective. And because you've used most of your glycogen stores, which is that intermediate fuel, your body is then forced to burn fat. The beauty here is it has nothing to do with calories in, calories out. It has everything to do with changing the main metabolic hormones in your body, which is shutting down the insulin and turning on the glucagon. To enter ketosis, you have to get your net carbs pretty low, close to 20 to 25 grams per day. So net carbs is the total carbs minus the grams of fiber. So for example, half a cup of broccoli has 5 grams of carbs, but 2.5 grams are from fiber. So when you subtract that, it comes down to only 2.5 grams of net carbs. So how can you tell if you're in ketosis? Well, most people can tell just by how they feel. They notice increased mental sharpness, stability in their energy, and suppression of their appetite. But if you want to confirm that you're in ketosis, you can do that with urine test strips. And these are readily available without a doctor's prescription. You can get them at your local pharmacy or online. And these are pretty accurate for the first month of ketosis. After that, you have to use a blood ketone meter. Of course, testing is completely optional, but some people find this really helpful. For example, if you're a diabetic working hard to reverse your diabetes, it can be a really helpful tool to confirm that you're doing the diet properly. So what are some of the health benefits of the keto diet? I mean, I know this diet sounds very extreme. Why would anyone want to do this? Well, the first benefit is the ability to shut down your hunger. So excessive hunger and uncontrolled appetite is usually a result of uncontrolled insulin levels. So when we shut down the insulin levels, your hunger goes away. So again, this can be a really helpful diet for a lot of people. The second benefit is it helps you burn fat. So a lot of people have extra body fat on their abdomen or love handles, and they're frustrated because they just can't get their body to burn fat. Well, the keto diet is the ultimate way to get your metabolism shifted over to burning fat as fuel. The third benefit is it's the most powerful diet to reverse diabetes. So type 2 diabetes is caused by insulin resistance. So when we are able to shut down the insulin, we're able to get people to lose weight and get off medications. So it's really effective at reversing diabetes. Number 4, it's extremely effective at reducing inflammation. So sugar and carbs are a huge source of inflammation, and insulin drives inflammation. So the keto diet can be a powerful tool for helping those with autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis and lupus who are suffering from joint pain from inflammation. So a lot of these patients notice that their joint pain goes away on a keto diet. Number 5 is it's neuroprotective, so it's good for brain cells. So it really works well for people with neurodegenerative conditions like Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, MS, as well as children with epilepsy. Number 6 is it can be used to starve cancer cells. So cancer cells need sugar to survive, so they're super reliant on sugar as a fuel source. So there's something called the Warburg effect, which explains why cancer cells are more reliant on sugar than other cells in your body. So normally what happens when you eat a lot of sugar and carbs, that increases insulin, IGF-1, and mTOR, which all promote the growth of cancer cells. So when you run out of sugar in your body on the keto diet, this poses a problem for cancer cells. If you'd like to learn more about cancer and the Warburg effect, I have a whole video on that, so I'm gonna link that below. Number 7 is the keto diet is great for promoting longevity. So it kind of mimics fasting, and it's able to reduce inflammation and the production of advanced glycation end products and oxidative stress. So overall, ketones are a much cleaner burning fuel compared to glucose. So when you burn glucose for fuel, you get waves of energy, and your body generates some reactive oxygen species, which are like free radicals that your body then has to clean up. Versus when you're burning ketones for fuel, you get stable energy with minimal free radicals. So the keto diet is also helpful for a couple other conditions. One of them is polycystic ovary syndrome, also known as PCOS. So PCOS is a very common condition that affects 10 to 15% of reproductive age women. And these women suffer from irregular periods, weight gain, and infertility. They often have high insulin levels, and insulin is controlling the way the ovary produces hormones, like testosterone. So the research shows the keto diet is really effective for women with PCOS. And I have a whole video dedicated to PCOS. If you'd like to learn more, I'm going to link that below as well. The keto diet's also great for stabilizing mood and anxiety because a lot of mood fluctuations stem from fluctuations in the blood sugar. It can also be great for people who suffer from frequent migraine headaches. The keto diet's also great for reversing fatty liver disease. So you might be wondering, how is a diet high in fat going to reverse fatty liver disease? Well, that's because fatty liver is actually caused by high insulin levels. So carbs and sugars drive up the insulin, and that tells your liver cells to generate and store fat. So it actually has nothing to do with fat in the diet. I have a whole video dedicated to fatty liver, so if you want to learn more about it, I'm going to link that below as well. So who should consider a keto diet? If you have type 2 diabetes, and if you've struggled to get it under control and you've already tried a paleo diet, then the keto diet can be extremely effective. If you're overweight or obese, the keto diet is great to help you lose the extra fat. If you're just looking to lose extra fat on your body, like love handles, then the keto diet is excellent. If you're looking to improve your memory or cognition, the keto diet can be really helpful. If you feel really hungry on other diets, then go on a keto diet. And finally, it's great for those who have active cancers. So research shows that it actually improves the efficacy of chemo and radiation, and it improves outcomes in brain cancers. So now let's talk about the dirty keto diet versus the clean keto diet. So the dirty keto diet is very similar to the Atkins diet, which was made popular by Dr. Robert Atkins in 1972. So this type of diet is low carb, but it's very high in saturated fats. So it's a lot of red meat, butter, bacon, cheese. And the problem with this diet is it can cause your LDL, which is your bad cholesterol, to skyrocket. I've actually seen patients on this type of diet with LDLs over 200, which is super high because keep in mind, a normal LDL is under 100. So LDL again is the bad cholesterol and HDL is the good cholesterol. The other problem is if you're eating a lot of meats and dairy products, that can be inflammatory on the body. Now, people who follow this type of diet, their argument is that because they're eating no carbs, the cholesterol is not going to stick to their arteries. So the truth is saturated fats plus carbs equals inflammation. Now, if someone on this type of dirty keto diet with a very high LDL accidentally returns to carbs or sugars, then we have a big problem because that's when we really worry about the cholesterol sticking to their arteries. Now you can ask your doctor to run some advanced cholesterol markers, which are like oxidized LDL and small dense LDL. And these can be helpful tools to let us know if your cholesterol is really in the danger zone. So the most definitive way to know if there's a problem is to do a coronary artery calcium scan. This is basically a CT scan of your heart that measures the amount of calcium in each of the coronary arteries. If it comes back as zero, that's great news. That means there's no plaque in your arteries. But if it's positive, then we have to take your cholesterol seriously and get it under control so that it doesn't continue to progress. The other problem with the dirty keto diet is it's loaded in artificial sweeteners. If you go to the grocery store right now, you can find keto ice cream, keto cookies, keto candy, but they're all loaded in artificial sweeteners, and these are bad for the bacteria in your microbiome. In fact, some of these artificial sweeteners are considered obesogens, meaning they make you gain weight and they cause obesity. Finally, the dirty keto diet is very acidic on the body. So when your body metabolizes meats and dairy products, the byproducts are acidic. So that's very different from eating lots of vegetables, because when your body metabolizes vegetables, the byproducts are alkaline on the body. So an alkaline diet is considered anti-inflammatory versus an acidic diet, it's actually considered inflammatory on the body. So now let's talk about the clean keto diet. So the clean keto diet is really rich in vegetables because vegetables have all the phytonutrients and prebiotic fibers to keep your microbiome healthy. And vegetables are also very alkaline, again, which is anti-inflammatory on your body. The clean keto diet is also rich in monounsaturated fats, which are the good fats, like avocados, olive oil, nuts and seeds, and wild fish like wild salmon. Did you know that olive oil is actually great fuel for your brain? It has polyphenols, and one special polyphenol called oleocanthal. The sweetener of choice in the clean keto diet is stevia, because stevia is a natural sweetener which has no negative impact on the gut microbiome. You also want to be eating organic and non-GMO, and use fermented foods whenever possible. So that's like coconut yogurt, sauerkraut, and pickled vegetables, because these have natural probiotics which increase the diversity of your gut microbiome. For many people who are looking to lose weight, it's best to avoid dairy products because dairy increases your pancreatic release of insulin. But if you do decide to keep dairy as part of your diet, it's best to use it more as a garnish rather than a main part of a meal. But if you suffer from gut issues or autoimmune disease, it's best to avoid dairy products entirely. Now let's talk about the impact of the keto diet on the gut microbiome. So research has made it clear that your overall health and well-being is largely dependent on the health of the microbiome, which is that ecosystem of trillions of bacteria in your digestive tract. So that's why you want to keep up your intake of vegetables, because vegetables are a great source of phytonutrients and prebiotic fibers to feed all that good bacteria inside your microbiome. Sometimes when people are transitioning over to a keto diet, they experience constipation. So that's why it's so important that you keep up your fiber intake by eating lots of vegetables. You can also use supplemental fibers. There's many different soluble fibers to choose from. One of the most popular ones is psyllium husk. So if you're using psyllium, you want to gradually titrate up the dose until you get to 1 tablespoon twice a day. You can also use magnesium. So I like to use a chelated magnesium and take that at bedtime to make sure your bowels are regular. So you need to have a thriving microbiome to make something called postbiotics. So postbiotics are the end product when the bacteria in your gut digest the food that you eat. And these postbiotics strongly influence your energy and your metabolism. Now I want to introduce you to something called TMAO. So if you're eating a lot of red meat and dairy products, this feeds the bacteria in your gut to produce something called TMA, trimethylamine. And trimethylamine goes to your liver, and the liver turns it into TMAO, which is trimethylamine oxide. So unfortunately, TMAO is a toxic inflammatory compound, and high levels are associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease, which is heart disease, as well as stroke. You can actually get your TMAO level measured on your blood work now. It's actually available through Quest Diagnostics. So once again, this is why I strongly emphasize keeping a healthy balance between vegetables and meat in your diet. Now let's talk about intermittent fasting, also known as time-restricted eating. So this is when you eat 2 meals a day within an 8-hour window and you're fasting for the other 16 hours. So intermittent fasting is a great way to activate autophagy, which is when you're cleaning up all the garbage inside your cells and reducing inflammation. So normally when you're doing intermittent fasting, you're not actually in ketosis. You're actually just burning that intermediate fuel, which is glycogen. But if your diet is really lower in carbs, like if you're on a paleo diet, then it's possible to get into ketosis briefly during intermittent fasting. And that's why we sometimes refer to it as the backdoor to ketosis. So some people actually combine the keto diet with intermittent fasting, and that can be extremely effective at increasing the rate of fat burning and help them to lose weight even more quickly. So ultimately, the goal is to become metabolically flexible so that you can go from burning glucose to glycogen to ketosis quickly rather than days later. So our ancestors were actually very metabolically flexible. They would use carbs for fuel when food was available, and then they would go into fat burning, which is ketosis, during times of famine. So the problem is today so many people are metabolically inflexible. They just can't get their body to burn fat. So what are some of the tools you can use on a keto diet? Well, the first is MCT oil. So MCT oil stands for medium chain triglyceride oil, and it actually comes from coconut oil. So MCT oil is unique because it actually goes straight to your liver and gets turned into ketones. So it's great for making that transition over to ketosis a little bit easier. MCT oil is also great for cognitive function, mental sharpness, and it's great for energy. So you can use it anytime during the keto diet. Some people are sensitive to MCT and it causes a little bit of digestive upset. If that's the case, you can use MCT powder, which is better tolerated. So a lot of people enjoy drinking their morning cup of coffee blended with MCT oil. And that's a great way to give you energy without breaking your fast, because again, MCT actually helps you generate ketones. But it's important not to overdo it, because MCT technically is a saturated fat, so if you overdo it, it's going to cause your LDL to go up. Next, we have electrolyte powder. So electrolytes are great for giving your cells all the minerals that it needs to stay hydrated and to give you energy. So this has like sodium, potassium, chloride, magnesium, and ribose, so all of which can give you a lot of energy while you're on the keto diet. Next, it can be helpful to use digestive enzymes, because again, the keto diet is really high in fat. So you want to use an enzyme that has ox bile and pancreatin that really target the breakdown of fats. So this can make it easier on your GI tract to tolerate more fat, and this is especially helpful if you've had your gallbladder removed. One of my favorites is berberine. So if you suffer with insulin resistance, berberine, which comes from the root of the berberine plant, helps to activate those insulin receptors. And our Berberine Pro actually has berberine and alpha-lipoic acid, which is a powerful antioxidant to activate those insulin receptors. Next, I recommend probiotics. So probiotics are all the good bacteria for your microbiome. There's so many different probiotics out there, so it's good to experiment and see which ones improve your digestion and your bowel habits. Some of the most popular ones in my office are the probiotic 100 billion and the probiotic 225 billion. And these are best taken first thing in the morning on an empty stomach. I also recommend omega-3 fish oil because this is great for your brain and your heart, and it helps to reduce inflammation in your body. Another really helpful tool is methyl B complex. So the B vitamins are great for energy, stress, and they also help to reduce your carb cravings. So this could be really helpful on the keto diet. I also recommend vitamin D3 with K2. So you want to get your level optimized to 50 to 80 on your blood work. And this is really important because vitamin D3 influences your mood, your energy, and your metabolism. So you want to make sure to get this level optimized. And finally, I recommend essential magnesium. So this is a chelated magnesium that's really great for sleep, muscle recovery, and it also helps to move your bowels. So this can help prevent any constipation while you're on the keto diet. So what are some of the challenges of the keto diet? So the first one is keto flu. So this happens when you're transitioning between fuel sources. So this is when you can experience dehydration, loss of electrolytes, and symptoms include mental fog, muscle cramps, body aches, fatigue. So that's why it's best to transition over to ketosis as quickly as you can. That's why, again, the MCT oil is a great tool because it helps your body generate ketones, and drinking water with electrolytes so that you don't experience any dehydration. The next challenge is the LDL or bad cholesterol skyrocketing. But as I already mentioned, you want to just make sure to dial back on saturated fat and use more healthy fats like monounsaturated fats, avocados, olive oil, nuts and seeds, and salmon. Again, cholesterol issues normally arise on the dirty keto diet, not so much on the clean keto diet. The next challenge with the keto diet is it's very restrictive. And when a diet is restrictive, it's really hard to stick with it for a long time. The other challenge is the keto diet can make it more difficult to do intense workouts. For example, running, cycling, or heavy weightlifting. Because these types of activities demand a lot of glucose. Your muscles take up a lot of glucose when you're doing those types of exercises. So sometimes you have to adjust your activity to more gentler exercises on the keto diet. The next challenge is some people experience digestive upset from all the fat, or they experience constipation. So again, you can prevent this by using digestive enzymes and using a lot of fiber supplements like psyllium, eating a lot of vegetables, and maybe taking some magnesium at bedtime to keep your bowels moving. So now I want to share a case example. So I had a patient named Sheila, and she was a 55-year-old woman who came to see me. And when I first met her, she had uncontrolled diabetes. Her fasting blood glucose was over 300. Her hemoglobin A1C was over 13, which is super high because normal is under 5.7. And her fasting insulin was 35. Again, that's super high because ideal fasting insulin is 6. And her diabetes was so poorly controlled that her teeth were actually rotting. But she was determined to reverse her diabetes without any prescription medications. So first I put Sheila on a paleo diet. So a paleo diet is a grain-free diet. So I got her off rice, bread, pasta, cereals, and I also had her avoid all dairy products. I encouraged her to walk 45 minutes every day, and I gave her supplements that included berberine, which activates the insulin receptors, and also cinnamon chromium, which is another great way to activate the insulin receptors. Sheila did a great job of following the diet and doing her exercises. And when I saw her after 3 months, she had already lost 10 pounds and she was feeling so much better. Her hemoglobin A1C actually came down from over 13 to 10. So that was a big improvement. But she was noticing that her fasting blood sugars were still over 200. So what this was telling me was that she still had that intermediate fuel. Her glycogen was causing her fasting blood sugars to be high because the glycogen was just releasing glucose in the morning. So this told me that we needed to get Sheila into ketosis to get her diabetes under control. So I had her increase her good fats. So that was avocados, olive oil, wild salmon. And I had her also increase her exercise to twice a day. So she implemented the clean keto diet. And when I saw her 3 months later, I was absolutely astonished. She lost 30 pounds and her hemoglobin A1C was down to 5.7, which is absolutely amazing. That's the normal range. And her fasting insulin had come down to 7, which is almost ideal. The most important thing is she felt amazing. Her teeth were not rotting anymore and she had so much energy. And one of the things she noticed is that she wasn't even hungry anymore. So she ended up implementing the intermittent fasting along with the keto diet. And I think that's why she saw results so quickly. So this is a great case example showing the power of the clean keto diet to reverse diabetes without any prescription medications. So now I want to touch a little bit about women and ketosis. So I have a lot of female patients who come to me and they tell me that their husband lost 20 pounds on the keto diet and they only lost 5 pounds. So why is that? Well, that's because women have different hormones from men. And if there's problems in metabolizing or clearing some of the estrogens, this can make it difficult to lose weight. So a couple things I recommend for women who are trying the keto diet. First of all, it's really important that we keep the detox pathways open. So this means making sure you're having a good bowel movement every day. And then also I recommend take a methyl B complex to promote methylation, which is another form of detox pathways in your cells. I also recommend that you eat a lot of cruciferous vegetables. So this includes broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, and kale, because these have special compounds that improve the metabolism of estrogen in your body. Women also do much better on the clean keto diet, which is alkaline on the body, as opposed to the dirty keto diet, which is acidic on the body. So it's really important that women keep up their intake of vegetables to keep their body alkaline. Now, what if you're on the keto diet, but you notice that your weight has kind of plateaued and it's not budging? Well, there's a couple things to look into. First, are you eating too much protein? Because if you eat a lot of protein, that can actually turn into glucose and get you out of ketosis. So you have to keep the right ratios again. Make sure that you're eating 70% good fat and 25% protein only. Another possibility is that maybe you have high cortisol from chronic stress. So your adrenal glands produce cortisol, which is the bad stress hormone when you're under stress. And if the cortisol levels are high continuously, unfortunately, this makes you actually hold on to weight. Another thing to look into is, are you getting enough sleep? So if you're not getting enough hours of sleep, this actually causes your cortisol to go up, again, making it really hard to lose weight. The next thing to look into is your thyroid sluggish? So you want to make sure your doctor orders a complete thyroid panel to make sure there's no issues there. And finally, are you getting enough movement and exercise? So if you're not seeing your weight budge, maybe you need to increase the amount of exercise to get your metabolism boosted. So who should not do a keto diet? Well, the keto diet is not recommended if you're pregnant, nursing, underweight, or if you're a woman looking to get pregnant. So there is one exception, and that is women who have PCOS. So because these women have higher levels of insulin, the research actually shows that the keto diet is great for regulating their hormones and getting their cycles regular and actually improving their fertility. But if you have any hesitation, I always recommend that you talk to your physician to make sure it's safe for you to start a keto diet. So how long do you stay on a keto diet? So I like to think of the keto diet as a treatment phase diet. And ultimately, you want to transition to a more paleo diet, which is more sustainable. The problem is the keto diet is very restrictive. So when a diet is very restrictive, it's hard to sustain long term. So most people like to enjoy foods that are in season. For example, peaches may be in season, but unfortunately the keto diet doesn't allow any room for this. So once you've reached your health goals, whether it's losing substantial weight or reversing your diabetes, then we're able to add back more foods. For example, fruits or starchy vegetables like yams. But generally, I do advise people to continue to avoid grains, and that includes breads, pastas, cereals, rice, quinoa, because this again will increase the insulin and start them back up on the cravings for carbs and cause the weight to come back. So generally, we transition people from a keto diet to more of a paleo diet. And some people may choose to cycle in and out of ketosis to keep their weight under control. So ultimately, everyone has a different carb threshold depending on their activity level and metabolism. So it's good to adjust the diet based on the results that you're seeing. So now let's talk about exercise. Can you exercise on a keto diet? First, let me touch on intermittent fasting. So if you're doing intermittent fasting as part of a regular diet, exercise is not a problem because again, you have the intermediate fuel, which is your glycogen stores, and that will get converted back into glucose during exercise. But if you are in full-blown ketosis, then certain exercises may become more challenging. For example, high-intensity exercises like running, cycling, or heavy weightlifting may be more difficult because during those types of activities, your muscles demand glucose. And in ketosis, there is no glucose around. So you may need to adjust your exercise a little bit while in ketosis. So typically, gentler exercises are not a problem, like walking, yoga, or Pilates. So it's good to listen to your body to figure out which exercises are doable on the keto diet. Another tool that's helpful on the keto diet is exogenous ketone supplements. So some people notice that when they take it as a supplement, it can actually increase their exercise endurance. So that's something that you could try as well. Now, what's the difference between ketosis and diabetic ketoacidosis? Well, there's a huge difference. Diabetic ketoacidosis, again, is a life-threatening condition, and when it occurs, patients need to go to the hospital right away. They need to be hospitalized to get IV fluids as well as IV insulin to get their blood sugars under control. So this is completely different from ketosis, which is what I'm talking about today. So in ketosis, the blood levels of ketones are actually really low, so it's not actually affecting the blood pH. And again, the keto diet is so effective for type 2 diabetics who are insulin resistant and looking to lower their insulin levels. So in summary, the keto diet is a high-fat, very low-carb diet that's extremely effective at shutting down the insulin, shutting down your hunger, and getting you to burn fat and lose weight. It can also help to reverse diabetes, reduce inflammation, and improve your cognitive function. Intermittent fasting is also helpful because it activates autophagy and can be like the backdoor to ketosis. Ultimately, the goal is to become metabolically flexible so that you can burn fat when needed. Thanks so much for watching my video all about the keto diet. I definitely want to hear all your questions and comments, so be sure to post those below and I'll get back to you. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much and have a wonderful day.